getting a power base.
I know. It's really sad that one of the outcomes of the deportations of all these gang kids, which got really heavy in the 90s, was that we would export the LA gang culture to all these countries that didn't have them. El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, Belize, but also Mexico. I mean, people say what came from those countries is not true. I've been in those countries before when there was no gang kids.
Yeah.
We brought them over there. And I mean, by deporting them, heavily tattooed, Chicano eyes, yeah, Cholo gangsters, all the way down these countries, who ended up bringing in the gang life here from here, the prison life that they got from here, the way of selling drugs, yeah, extorting people, they all brought it down there. It's just really sad that LA, like Chicago and some of the big cities, is a world internationally known gang places.
Yeah.
And now we exported this to these countries.
It was interesting that your first book, what was it, La Vida Loca?
Yeah.
You wrote it and nobody bought it because they said, well, we've had a Hispanic last year.
I know, I know. And it took a while, but finally I think the world opened up where they realized, well, maybe we can start publishing these guys' names like Luis Rodriguez.
Yeah.
But it actually was good because it got me mad. I was going to give up writing.
Yeah.
And then when I got that letter from this one big publisher, and he says, well, we've already done a Hispanic book. We don't need to do no more. I like, whoa, I got mad.
Yeah.
I'm glad I hanged in there with it because it really was important to tell these stories.
You moved to Chicago with Trini.
Yeah. And Trini is my third, last wife.
Third and last.
She's still with me. We're almost 24 years married. She
yeah.
went through all my sobriety, all my problems with Ramiro. She went through hell and back, and she's still there. So I have to give her a lot of credit.
Yeah.
She's a very sweet, beautiful, intelligent woman who ended up being the one person that I could finally begin to get close to because I had a hard time with all my relationships.
Yeah.
And as you know, with all the women in the book, they're all great women. I don't really fault them. I fault myself. I sabotaged these really good relationships.
Yeah. Pursue that a little. How did you sabotage them?
I think because I either drank too much or I raged too much or a combination of both. I was easily bothered. I was easily upset, you know.
Yeah.
And some of the women were just good women, but maybe they were a little bit naive. Some
mm-hmm.
of them were probably too sweet compared to what I was, and they were getting knocked around by me. I don't mean knocked around physically. I didn't never hit a woman.
Yeah.
But there's ways to abuse people verbally, emotionally, that I didn't know that I was doing all the time.
Yeah.
I've had to cop to it now because I realize that that's one of my problems.
Yeah.
And obviously my wife Trini wouldn't tolerate that. She, you know, she's not gonna, she shouldn't.
Yeah.
So I've learned that you can abuse people different ways. Verbal and emotional abuse is one of the ways.
How do you stop a rage now? Because let's say it was pretty powerful, what you were, I mean, exploding into. And you talked about going to visit the Indian...
Native American, I think that spirituality helped me. They do the sweat lodges, which is very intense, but it's healthy. They have intense ceremonies that doesn't hurt you. And I needed intensity,
mm-hmm.
but I kept going towards it in the bad way. The intensity of the violence, the gang, when I let that go, the drinking, the drugs, there's so much intensity.
Yeah.
What ceremonial, Native American ceremonies like sweat lodges, like vision quests, like, well, all, any of them, they're intense, but it's community, it's healing, and I learned to heal. I have gone back to those traditions, because they are traditions, and they're part of my own indigenous background.
So no medication, no doctors?
No, because, you know, first of all, when I was on heroin, there was nothing. But even when I was quitting drinking, and I really wanted to avoid it. I was asked to go to a hospital because they said, you're going to need it. I avoided it. I did go to the recovery meetings. I kept coming and coming. But I really had a hard time with that whole concept. I really, especially when I opened up to the Native American, I realized there's a natural way to go under their guidance. And they do, as you know, Native American reservations have high alcoholism rates, high suicide rates, high trauma rates. So that helped me to be among people who understood what that was.
And you took Ramiro to a focus group.
Yeah.
Yeah. Did it help?
It helped him up to a point, but not enough.
Yeah.
Nothing was going to help him until he went through what he did.
Yeah. Which, he's been through hell.
He'd been through hell. And he spent a total of 15 years in prison from the age of 17 to 35. He had three kids who are now teenagers that he didn't raise. But the only good thing I would have to say, and if you know reading the book, he did get his life together somehow.
Yeah.
Coming out last year, he's free now. He's trying to be a good father. He's trying to be a good person. He's even working with gang kids now, turning their life around.
Is he working? Is somebody paying him for his time?
Yeah, but you know, that money is very short. Like, for example, he's got a job where he's working with 100 gang kids, and by next month, the funding is going away. It's a grant. You know how that goes. I'm hoping that he will have done good, well, that somebody else will pick him up from some other agency. But he loves this work. He realizes that's one thing he can do. He can help kids.
Mm-hmm. When you moved to Chicago, the difference in life there, and you were on a radio station.
Yeah. I actually worked for an all-news radio station that was tied to CNN and then later NBC. So I worked actually for CNN briefly under those things. And it was really good, all-news radio station. I wrote all the copy and did reporting. I wasn't on the air. I didn't have the radio voice. But I wrote, and it helped, writing those short 20, 30-second pieces and getting all these facts and making them short for the anchors. And it was, to me, kept me in the writing mode, kept me in that journalism. It was my last actual job for somebody else that I ever had.
And you were winning awards. I mean, you know, this is to have the two sides of life.
You're walking one foot in the world of my dreams, which was writing with awards, recognition, and then the world of trying to be a decent human being, which is very difficult. Trying to be a good father, trying to be somebody that could be sober. That was very difficult, but this other world was happening, and yet my other foot was stuck in, am I going to really get it together? Am I going to have some integrity in this world?
Yeah. And poor Andrea, when Camilla comes to Chicago, and maybe it was difficult for her to see you with another woman. She might not want you, but she didn't want anybody else to have you.
Yeah.
And the man she's living with, who tries to rape your daughter. You must have wanted to kill him.
Yeah, it was one of those terrible things. Again, my rages could have resulted in some terrible thing. I was angry enough where I could confront him, but I held back actually hurting the guy. Yeah. I wanted to, but that's where you have to start controlling it. Obviously, my original thing would have been, I would have hurt him, I would have been in prison. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
That's what I had to avoid.
Yeah.
But I still had to confront him, you know.
Oh.
You still have to deal with these issues without hurting people. That's part of the problem.
Yeah.
Of knowing to be firm, to stay strong, but not lose yourself. You know?
But it was important, I felt, reading it, for Andrea to see that you protected her.
Yeah, because, you know, my kids felt that I neglected them, and I did. And they wouldn't tell me things anymore. And this is one instance where my daughter came to me.
Yeah.
And I was really glad, because maybe she began to trust that I could do something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Pretty grim. And then, when the book is published, the first time you see your book with your name on the cover.
I know. It's, you know, it was kind of like a weird thing that when I was younger, I used to go to libraries, and there was a point when I started imagining my name on the shelves.
Will you read Romero's letter at the last of the book?
Yeah, and this was what he wrote right after he got out of prison.
Yeah.
And it goes like this. I've had over 13 years of psychological warfare. My mind has been a battlefield with many casualties, disconnections, reconnections. Everything's new. It feels good to see my kids, my family, and everyone who has supported me. It feels good to know that on this next journey of my life, I don't have to do it alone. This is a new journey for everybody. All the hardships, the struggles were not just my own. While I did time, everyone else did life. As I stepped out the prison door and saw my family and friends standing in front of me, I didn't want to look behind me. Behind me was the solution. In front of me was absolution. Now I'm going forward, taking advantage of all my support, not afraid to ask for help when needed. For too long, I was trying to do everything alone. I was selfish and weak, full of pain and full of pride, holding on to so much anger, never knowing what I was truly angry at. That's all over with. All that sadness and hurt, I want it to be gone. I look into my children's eyes, and all I can do is smile. I wake up with a smile. I walk everywhere with a smile. I smile because I finally made it home.
Yeah, beautiful. I love that. I did time while they did life.
Yeah, ain't that something?
And I just hope, I pray for you, that he keeps it up, because until he has also been, I suppose, exposed to depression again, he won't know, will he make it?
We're going to be there with him, and I know that he's capable of being going back anytime. we're going to do whatever we can. But I think the most important thing is that he finds that strength within himself.
Yeah.
That he says he's committed, but you know how hard it is for these guys. Work, it's hard. People don't want to give him the time of day. We're going to try to stand by him because I think we have to help him help himself. He yeah. needs to learn to finally do it himself.
Is he traveling with you?
No, he can't because of parole. They won't let him out of the state.
Oh.
In 3 years, he'll be out of this parole, and yeah. then he will definitely be going with me when he can.
Yeah. Well, I wish you all the best,
thank
and to
so
him,
much.
Luis. It is. They may call you back, but they're calling back a different person.
There you go.
Will you my autograph
honor.
My
thank
book?
Thank you so
thank
much.
You. And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. You can link into YouTube that has a whole channel with our older shows from this year. And support your local library, because libraries are our finest democratic institution in America. And there are some pretty great books you might want to read, including Hector Tober's new book, The Barbarian Nurseries. It's fiction, but oh, what a story. Again, talking about the bigotry that exists in Orange County, in Los Angeles, people who are different, i.e., that means they're not white. I don't know what not white means, because today it seems you go with the DNA, everybody has a drop of something from the beginning. But that's one of the books we've liked recently. But that supporting the library is so important. They are having their funds cut off. They are, you, whatever you can do to keep that library open on weekends at night, do it. But again, go and thank the librarian, because he or she really makes a difference in the world. What did a library mean to you growing up?
It was life-saving. The library was the one place I can go where I could find books and have my refuge.
Yeah. I hope you're speaking at libraries now.
I do, and librarians are like some of my best friends now.
So. Yeah. Yeah. They are the great people
they are great.
Who are not always appreciated.
Yeah.
And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much, Luis.
Of course, my pleasure.